Hello, I'm Rahat Hussein. I'm going to be giving you some very practical tips on how to perform laser peripheral iridotomy. So I'm not going to dwell too much on the indications. We know we perform this procedure for patients with primary angle closure disease, be that suspects or PAC or even PACD. Let's just talk a little bit about the benefits. Why do we do this procedure? Well, the main reason is to reduce the risk of developing acute angle closure. So in other words, a sudden rise in pressure. And it also may reduce the risk of a chronic angle closure process, but the evidence for that is more scarce. So in other words, they may still develop glaucoma and they still may need drops and even surgery. So I think that's very important that we mention that to patients when we're counseling them before this procedure. Of course, there's risk and side effects. I think one of the main ones that has to be mentioned and documented is that they may get glare or lines or a shadow in their vision. You can describe it in different ways. Normally, that's towards the bottom of their vision, and that can happen in about as many as 20% of cases. So it's certainly something you've got to mention. What I normally say is that some patients do get these symptoms of a glare or a shadow at the bottom of their vision. In most cases, it does wear off after a period of time. But there are some cases where it becomes more persistent. So the patients need to be aware of that. If they ask for specific figures, I guess it's about 1% where these symptoms will become troublesome or more long-term. I usually add on something like, you know, I have had a few patients who have had long-term glare and shadows, but most patients actually feel it doesn't bother them too much. But something you've got to mention and document. They may get a pressure spike afterwards, so that's why I always say we measure your pressure about half an hour after the procedure, and we may need to give you some drops or even tablets sometimes if the pressure goes up, but usually that's fairly transient. And potentially there's a risk of corneal damage, which may necessitate further treatment, although that's pretty rare. And again, it's very important that you document all these things in the notes. So let's get on to the practicalities of it, how to do it. Well, in SNEC, the nurses will have already instilled some pilocarpine a few times and some alphagan. This is to reduce the risk of a pressure spike afterwards. Patients sometimes complain of a brow ache and a dimming of the vision, and you can explain to them that this is because of the pilocarpine, and the effects will wear off in a few hours. And if they're complaining of a bit bad brow ache, you can offer them some paracetamol. So then you take them to the argon laser room, that's room 61 for the Pascal or room 62 for the diode. You can use either. I mean, I've used both and they're both fairly effective. And of course, timeout procedure. Put in some topical anesthesia and just warn the patient that this can be a bit uncomfortable. So again, what I usually say is I say, listen, I've never had this procedure myself, but patients often tell me that sometimes it can be a bit uncomfortable. Some patients say they don't feel anything at all, but no one runs out of the room screaming in agony. So it's a little bit of discomfort, but not too bad. Then you put on the Abraham iridotomy argon lens with a coupling agent, so some Vidizic, and I'll show you a picture of that lens in a moment. And I ask the patient to look to your opposite shoulder. So for example, if you're doing their right eye, ask them to look at your right shoulder, or failing that, just say, just look down a little bit. So you want to choose a site either sort of 11 or 1 o'clock, so in other words, just off 12 o'clock position. You don't want to go too peripheral, because if you go too peripheral, you're quite near the cornea, that's one thing. Secondly, it can be a little bit difficult to do if you go too peripheral. And also, if you get bubbles, which often happens, the bubbles have got nowhere to go. So just go just in a little bit from the periphery, and I'll show you a picture in a second where it might be a good spot to do it. The settings are around about 700 milliwatts, 50 micrometers, 50 milliseconds, and you aim to do about 10 or 20 shots. Now, these settings will vary a little bit depending on which consultant you're with, so there is a bit of flexibility there. And when you're doing the argon, really the aim is really just to create a crypt, a crater, and not to go through in actual fact, although that does sometimes happen and it's not the end of the world if it does, but really you're trying to just thin out the iris in that area so that when you go in with the YAG, you can do it in one or two shots. Quite commonly, you get a little bubble forming when you do this argon. And what you all you need to do is just give it a little flick with the on the lens itself. And it needs to be quite a firm flick, and you'll find the bubble dislodges. Occasionally, if it doesn't dislodge with the flick, just ask the patient just to sit back and just move their head a little bit. And then when you bring them back again, often the bubble is gone. So let's just play a little video here of what the lens looks like. So you can see ocular instruments, Abraham, and it's got IRID laser on it. And if you sort of tilt it forward, you'll see there's a little magnified section there, which is the section that you look through when you put it on the lens. So have a look at that lens, and that's the one you use. Okay, so this is just some pictures of the actual what you see when you get down to the laser room. So the top two pictures are the Pascal. So you can see that the power settings there, it says 700. And then this is actually 60 micrometers. It doesn't go lower than that. It's obviously the single dot. You don't want to have any patterns here. So if it's got different patterns, you might want to click on show all patterns. You just want a single dot. And repetition rate off, of course, and exposure here is 50 microseconds. So this is how you'd set it up here. And of course, you've got the viewing piece here, and which is, and you know, it's difficult to explain on this presentation, but you'll need to set that up properly as well. This here is the diode here. So again, you've got 50 microseconds. On the actual eyepiece itself, you'll be able to adjust the size of the spot, which I would suggest maybe 50 micrometers. Again, you've got 700 milliwatts here, and this is the number of shots that you're doing. So again, you're aiming to about 10 to 20 shots, something along that line. So this is a picture of an eye. So obviously I put these little dots in here. This is just an idea of where you'd probably want to aim. So you're not too peripheral, but neither are you sort of around about here. You don't want to go too near the pupil margin, because for various reasons, number one is glare will be more obvious. And secondly, don't forget the lens is just behind the iris at this point, whereas at this point, the lens is a bit further away from the iris. So really, this would be a sort of ideal position to go into. So what I often do is I look in the low magnification first. I make a mental note of roughly where I'm going to go. So for example, in this picture, I'd say, okay, so I'm kind of going to go where that line is at that sort of level, and maybe just a bit in from that area there. That might be a good spot to do it on actually, because it's a bit thin there, but maybe a little bit too peripheral unless you're quite experienced. So you've done the argon, you've thinned it out, you've made a little crater, and then you take them over to the YAG room, which is 67 on, you know, in our setting. Sometimes if there's been a bit of a delay between the argon and the YAG, you can put a bit more topical anesthesia, but if you're just doing it straight off, there's no need really. So now you use the Abraham YAG iridotomy lens with a coupling agent, and again, I'll show you a video in a second. Make sure that on the laser itself is set to posterior focus. Warn the patient that this can actually be a bit more uncomfortable compared to the argon. So I often say it's like a shock or a flick to the eye. And you know, once you do this, you'll know exactly what I'm talking about, and you'll be able to tailor your conversation accordingly. Again, ask your patient to look to the opposite shoulder. And as I said to you, I start on low magnification first. I look at the iridotomy crater itself, and I make sure it's at the center of that magnified lens section, as opposed to on the edge of it. Once I'm quite clear where I'm going to go, then I put it to the highest magnification setting possible using the little dial on the side of the viewing microscope. And then you'll see the red aiming beam. Now, if you turn that aiming beam brightness very bright, you'll find that the aiming beam is very fuzzy margins, where if you turn it down quite low brightness, you'll get much more discrete points. That's another little tip. And what you want to do is really aim those dots when they come together. So it'll start off as two dots, and you sort of push it forward and back, and it'll turn into one dot. And you want to aim for that one single dot at the bottom of the crypt, which you have previously created. Okay. Often these are things that are easy to describe once you're actually doing it. But, you know, this gives you an idea. I start off at about 2.5 millijoules, and often all you need is just one shot. Now, sometimes you need a few more, 5 or 6 or so. Another little tip is don't keep pressing it. So if you've done one shot, don't press for the second shot straight away. You need to give it about 10 seconds between shots for the power to build up. If you just keep pressing it, the power will go down very quickly. And you know your end point is essentially a gush of fluid through the hole that you've created. So once you get that gush, sometimes you may want to enlarge it a little bit more, but essentially the gush is what you're looking for. I think if you have to do more than about 10 shots of YAG, it means, you know, it's not going quite straightforward, and you may need to call for help if you're a junior. Or what you can sometimes do is take them back to the argon room, make that crypt a little bit deeper, and then bring them back again. Or sometimes what I've had to do, particularly if the patient is in discomfort, I say, well, why don't we do this another day, or maybe in an hour's time, once the inflammation's all settled down, then you go back to it again. So don't be afraid of having of doing that if need be, rather than just shooting away and way, you know, and getting nowhere. So this is a picture of the YAG machine in room 67. So this is what I was talking about. So it's got three settings, anterior, zero, posterior. I tend to sit on the posterior setting for the iridotomy. And this is what the screen looks like. So this is one shot, two shots, three shots. So you just keep on one shot. Some surgeons like to have it on two or three, but I'll just keep on one shots. This is the amount for each shot. So 2.6 millijoules, and you can adjust the power using this dial. So if you click on here on the screen and then you turn this dial, you'll be able to adjust the power. This is the number of shots in total. This is to reset it. And this is actually the brightness of your focusing beam. So remember I told you it goes up to 10. So keep it on sort of, you know, 1, 2, 3, something like that, and you'll get a much more discreet laser aiming beam. That's all. And this is obviously the on and off button. So sometimes with this laser machine, you get funny sort of sounds. And if you get anything funny like that, just turn it off and on with the key, and then it often works again. So here's a little video of what the actual the YAG laser lens looks like. So it's got IRID YAG on it. And again, it's got a slightly larger magnification central point there. So that's where you want to put the center of your crypt onto that central area. So once you've done the laser treatment, everything's gone fine, you'll need to get the nurse to check the pressure in about half an hour's time. So ask the patient to wait outside and say the nurse will check the pressure in about half an hour. So drops, this is going to vary between consultant to consultant. So what I tend to do, I say, look, for that first day, in other words, I do my lasers usually in the morning, I say put in Predfort, so prednisolone 1% hourly until they go to bed. And then four times a day for another 6 days. So that's 1 week in total. But individual consultants will have their own regime for that. And you may want to check with them. I tend to see my patients in about 2 weeks' time, but that will vary again for individual patients. If I'm worried about their pressure or their discs, I might want to see them a bit earlier. On the other hand, if it's just a PACS and everything else is fine, I might say, well, 3 weeks or so. So around about 2 weeks' time. Do tell the patient they can eat, they can wash, they can do really everything all normally. I tend to give them 1 day MC, you know, 2 days if they really want, but actually they can pretty much go back to normal by the next day. And that's it, actually. So it's just some points on how to do the laser peripheral iridotomy. But if in doubt, you can always just check with the anyone in the glaucoma department. We're all pretty approachable. Thanks very much.